It's no coincidence that as the granddaughter of a pastor and the daughter of an evangelist that I would find myself in a communications capacity. An evangelist sees their job as spreading the good news of the gospel. As a communicator, I see my job as promoting racial and social justice causes that would otherwise go unnoticed or unappreciated. I do this by working the phones, calling reporters, emailing them, reaching out to bloggers, TV hosts, and telling them about the work that grassroots groups are doing in states across the country. The joy that I feel after getting the Washington Post or the New York Times or CNN to cover an article that would otherwise go unnoticed is unrivaled. You see, the same way that religion is a tool to allow some to accomplish lofty and seemingly insurmountable goals, communications can be used in that way as well. Having worked for a variety of racial justice and progressive institutions, I can tell you with certainty that you do not need $1 million in the bank to promote your cause. What you do need is grit, determination, and the keys to strike while the iron is hot. The phrase strike while the iron is hot has been around for decades. It means to maximize opportunities. But it also means, rather than being passive and waiting for things to come your way, you're constantly working. And when you see the opportunity, you jump on it with reckless abandon. Let me tell you the steps or the keys to strike while the iron is hot. First, you need to believe in something bigger than yourself. Next, you need to be willing to maximize opportunities. Finally, you need to be persistent. Let me ask you a question. When was the last time you got really fired up about something? When was the last time you experienced righteous indignation? What did you do? How did you feel? The last time I got really fired up about something and believed in something bigger than myself, it happened right here in North Carolina. You see, I had just finished the Nike Women's Half Marathon in Washington, D.C. I was exhausted, right? I had just run 13.1 miles. I wanted to go home, take a shower, sit on the couch, and eat the biggest cupcake I could find. Like, not a little small one, but like large, massive. The problem is, I had already committed to come to North Carolina and learn about a movement called the Moral Mondays, and it was led by the Reverend Dr. William J. Barber of the North Carolina NAACP. So instead of sitting on the couch eating my cupcake, I showered, grabbed my bags, and boarded a plane to North Carolina. I was exhausted. When I walked into the church for the planning meeting, although I walked in tired, I left on fire. At that meeting, I experienced one of the greatest displays of camaraderie and compassion that I had ever seen before in my life. I saw people black and white, young and old, Asian, Latino, people of faith with people who professed no faith at all, Christians and Muslims, and they were all united around a single belief that they wanted the state of North Carolina to be better. They showed such respect and genuine love for each other, I was struck. They decided that they were going to go to the state capitol every single Monday, and they would protest and urge their legislators to remember to govern for the good of the whole rather than a small select few. I decided, you know what? I can use my communication skills to help them as well. The very first Monday, there were probably 30 people. Eventually, over the course of just a few weeks, that number grew to tens of thousands. I committed that I was going to do everything in my power to support the work that they were doing. So many weeks, I flew from Washington, D.C. to North Carolina. On weeks when I couldn't physically be here, I asked my deputy to come. My deputy is based in New York City. That means that she was flying from the Big Apple to the Tar Heel State, and we were trading off. Do you understand how tiring that could be? But we didn't let it stop us. We believed in what was happening here, and we were committed that we wanted to share this story with the national stage. We wanted to ensure that what was happening in North Carolina was not limited to the confines of this city or this state. We wanted people in Florida, Georgia, California, Texas, Ohio to hear what was happening here and to be inspired that they too could move mountains in their own states. And so that's what we did. The thing is, when you believe in something bigger than yourself, you're willing to go the extra mile. And you can't strike while the iron is hot if you don't have that passion. When you have the passion and you talk about it, it's contagious. And what happens is you inspire people to take action. Without that, people listen to a story and they go on their way. The next element to striking while the iron is hot is maximizing the moment. Entrepreneurs, they can work on an issue for years. They can introduce a concept only to see it be greeted with skepticism or lukewarm reactions, but they continue working on it. Every once in a while, a moment comes, and that moment gives them an opportunity to really elevate the issue or the concept that they're pushing. Advancement Project knows this well too. For years, we've been a leader or a pioneer in the movement to end the overcriminalization of youth of color in schools across the country. What do I mean by that? In many schools across the country, children of color are suspended, they're arrested, they're expelled for minor offenses or offenses that aren't offenses at all. As a communications professional, I'm constantly thinking about ways to tell this story. It makes no sense if me and the organization that I work for, if we know about it, but we aren't sharing it with the world and encouraging people to take action. So we decided that we were going to produce an animated video. And thinking about the video, I'm thinking about who are the best messengers to share this message. Around the same time, I heard about a 17-year-old honor student from Florida. Her name is Kiara Wilmot. And Kiara Wilmot was really enthusiastic about science. She created a makeshift volcano, and the makeshift volcano did what it was supposed to do, and it erupted. Well, Kiara was excited, and she did what any of us would have done. She went to the school, she showed her teacher the makeshift volcano, and Kiara thought that she would be greeted with a pat on the back. Do you know what she got instead? She was escorted to the principal's office, she was arrested, she was charged with 2 felonies. She was expelled. All this for curiosity. When I heard about Kiara's story, I thought, you know what, this is an important story to share. If it can happen to an honor student, how much more for my son? How much more for other students? So I reached out to Kiara's family's attorney, introduced myself, told him a little bit about my organization, asked them if he could put me in touch with the family. He agreed. I spoke with Kiara's mother, Marie, told her what I was working on, asked her if I could feature Kiara's story in our video, and she agreed. So the maximizing the moment in this instant was hearing about something, thinking about how it connected to the work that I was already doing, reaching out to the family. After the video was created, the next question is, okay, when do I release it? Now, as a communications professional, I am not in the business of doing things that aren't going to have an impact. So I had to think about the most ideal time to release the video. I wanted media to cover it. I wanted those charges to be dropped, and I wanted to really make a difference for her, but also raise an alarm to people across the country that this is an issue that we need to get involved in. A few weeks later, I get an email from Kiara's mother. She told me that Kiara would not only graduate, but that she had been accepted into college. And I thought, here's my hook. Here's the opportunity to release the video. And so that's what we did. I got with my digital media team. We released the video. We pushed it out on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter. Within the first 24 hours of releasing the video, it garnered 17,000 views. Now, for my organization, a video, you know, this type of video with this many views, it was like a huge accomplishment. Not only that, but in addition to the views, media reached out to Kiara. They started telling her story. Eventually, the charges were dropped, and her record was expunged. Now, I know that Kiara's story is, it's not always the norm. There are many kids who experience things like this and they don't overcome. However, if we continue to work on this issue and maximize moments, we can make a measurable impact for students all across this country. The next key to striking while the iron is hot is persistence. So once you believe in something bigger than yourself, once you maximize the moment, you still need to be persistent. And persistence is going the extra mile when everything around you tells you to give up. Wouldn't it be nice to get into college without having to submit an exam? To getting an A on a test with minimal effort? I mean, trust me, my 15-year-old son, he would love that. Just turn in the paper and you get an A. As a communications professional, I would love to call reporters and on the very first call, on the very first email, they say, yes, Jennifer, I will cover your story. But that's not always how it works. I once spent over a year getting Reverend Barber on HBO's Real Time with Bill Maher. And the way that this worked is, as I said, we decided that we wanted this story to reach all across the United States. And so we were always thinking about ways to tell the story and capture the attention of people who were just in different cities and states, and people who could also carry it to a broader audience. The Moral Monday protest started in April of 2013. In May of 2013, I received a call from Bill Maher's producer, and she had heard about the movement and was interested in having him on the show. I thought, great. As a communications professional, this is a highlight. I could die right now. I mean, this is just wonderful. There's nothing higher. A few days later, she emails me and she says, look, we're gonna have to drop the segment. So I'm deflated. You know, I had already told everyone that it was gonna happen and I'm deflated. But then I realized, wait a minute, this producer made the mistake of giving a PR person, not just her email, but her phone number, right? So I decided that I was gonna reach out to her periodically. I didn't wanna be labeled a stalker, so I said that I would just send periodic email updates, and that's what I did. A few months later, she reached out again and said, look, I think we can have him on the show. And by this point, it's probably July of 2013. I'm excited. Then she has to pull back. Long story short, this process went on from May of 2013 until July of 2014 when he was finally on the show. Had I stopped at the first no that I received, had the producer decided that she wasn't gonna be persistent, this never would have happened. And again, the significance of this show is while we're covering the story and we're sharing it with media, it's one thing if Channel 13 here in Raleigh covers it. It's another thing if HBO covers it. If HBO covers it, it reaches a broader audience. And what I want people to see is that you can move mountains, you can make a difference. And so I had to ensure that this story was told on a mass scale. If you think about the building blocks that I've just shared, believing in something bigger than yourself, maximizing the moment, being persistent, why does it matter? Well, it matters because in everything that we do, whether you're a PR person, whether you're a doctor, whether you're a lawyer, whether you're a student, we're not in this to be mediocre. We're in this to truly change the world. We're in it to move mountains. If you want to move mountains, you need the keys to strike while the iron is hot. Thank you very much.